And the text that we're going to focus on is near the end of chapter 3. It's chapter 3, verses 6 through 13. 1 Thessalonians, chapter 3, 6 through 13. And so this is what I'm going to do. I want to give you a context for this passage. We're going to focus in on this passage. But there's a context for the passage that is incredibly important. If we're really going to see, I think, what the Spirit wants us to get from this, we've got to understand the context between Paul and Timothy and Silvanus and the believers in Thessalonica that he's writing to. And so, to give you the context, what I'm going to do is I'm going to read the first three chapters of the book. The first thought I had when I thought I really need to read the first three chapters of the book is, oh, I need to apologize for that. You know, because we're not used to reading such lengthy passages of the Scripture when we gather to worship. And then I thought, how sad is it that I would even have the thought that I should apologize for reading the text? I think that says something about our culture, though, and what our expectations are. It will not make the sermon longer. I will cut my remarks down so that we have room for the text, okay? But it's important that we read this. I'm going to start with verse 2 after the greeting. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 says this, "We give thanks to God always for all of you, constantly mentioning you in our prayers, remembering before our God and Father the work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers, loved by God, that He has chosen you, because our gospel came to you, not only in word, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit with full conviction. You know what kind of men we proved to be among you for your sake, and you became imitators of us and of the Lord. For you received the word in much affliction with the joy of the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For not only has the word of the Lord sounded forth from you in Macedonia and in Achaia, but your faith in God has gone forth everywhere, so that we need not say anything." Your faith in God has gone forth everywhere, so that we need not say anything. Remember that line, it's important. Verse 9, "For they themselves report concerning us the kind of reception we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for His Son from heaven, whom He raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come." There was a radical response to the gospel when they came and preached in Thessalonica. A radical response to the gospel. And it wasn't just in word, but it was with the power of the Holy Spirit, and they responded, and they turned from worshiping idols to worshiping God and putting their faith and hope and trust in Jesus Christ, who they looked to return and keep His promises. So much so that their faith just went out everywhere. And word came back to Paul and Silvanus and Timothy about the impact that they had had. This is a big deal. Chapter 2. "For you yourselves know, brothers, that our coming to you was not in vain. But though we had already suffered and had been shamefully treated at Philippi, as you know, we had boldness in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in the midst of much conflict. For our appeal does not spring from error or impurity or any attempt to deceive. But just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak not to please man, but to please God who tests our heart. For we never came with words of flattery, as you know, nor with a pretext for greed, God is witness, nor did we seek glory from people, whether from you or from others, though we could have made demands as apostles of Christ. For we were gentle among you, like a nursing mother taking care of her own children. So being affectionately desirous of you, we were ready to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you had become very dear to us. For you remember, brothers, our labor and toil. We worked night and day that we might not be a burden to you, while we proclaimed to you the gospel of God. You are witnesses, and God also, of how holy and righteous and blameless was our conduct towards you believers. For you know how, like a father with his children, we exhorted each one of you and encouraged you and charged you to walk in a manner worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. And we also thank God constantly for this, that when you received the word of God which you heard from us, you accepted it, not as the word of men, but as what it really is, the word of God, which is at work in you believers. For you, brothers, became imitators of the churches of God in Christ Jesus that are in Judea. For you suffered the same things from your own countrymen as they did from the Jews, who both killed the Lord Jesus and the prophets and drove us out, and displeased God and opposed all mankind by hindering us from speaking to the Gentiles that they may be saved, so as always to fill up the measure of their sins. But God's wrath has come upon them at last. But since we were torn away from you, brothers, for a short time, in person, not in heart, for we endeavored the more eagerly and with great desire to see you face to face, because we wanted to come to you. I, Paul, again and again, but Satan hindered us. For what is our hope or joy or crown of boasting before our Lord Jesus at his coming? Is it not you? For you are our glory and joy. In chapter 2, you see Paul, after this response to the gospel that was just amazing, you see the way he describes the relationship that he has with those believers in Thessalonica. He says that we were like a nursing mother, tender with you, that we were like a father in the way that he instructs his children. He talks about this familial connection that he has with them and the deep love and relationship that he has for them. And the fact that there was adversity. There was adversity when they preached the gospel, and then when the believers in Thessalonica responded, they experienced the same kind of adversity that believers in Judea had experienced. And despite all that, they still followed Jesus and put their faith in him. And this deep relationship was built between Paul and the believers in Thessalonica. So much so that Paul says, I wanted to come back to see you guys so bad, but Satan hindered me. The enemy was messing with me. He was getting in my way and preventing me from coming to see you again. Chapter 3. Therefore, when we could bear it no longer, we were willing to be left behind in Athens alone. And we sent Timothy, our brother, and God's co-worker in the gospel of Christ, to establish and exhort you in your faith, that no one be moved by these afflictions. For you yourselves know that we're destined for this. For when we were with you, we kept telling you beforehand that we were to suffer affliction, just as it's come to pass, and just as you know. For this reason, when I could bear it no longer, I sent to learn about your faith, for fear that somehow the tempter had tempted you and our labor would be in vain. Paul says, I love you guys so much, and I wanted to come to you so bad, but the enemy kept preventing me. And so when we couldn't stand it any longer, I allowed myself and Silvanus to be left in Athens, and I sent Timothy on ahead, because I had to know. I was worried. I was worried that the tempter had maybe come and stolen something away from you. And because of that, I was willing to let Timothy go on alone so that he could come and check on you, so that he could encourage you in your faith and build you up in your faith and make sure that you were okay. So that what we had done in preaching the gospel among you and the gospel response that you had would not be in vain. And that's what brings us to verse 6 in chapter 3. And this is what we're going to focus on. We're going to focus on 6 through 13, this second half. But I wanted you guys to understand and hear from Paul and Silvanus and Timothy's own mouth the amazing conversion experience that they had, the revival that they had in Thessalonica, how they turned away from idols and put their faith in Christ. And it was such an amazing thing that word of it spread all over the place. Their faith spread to Macedonia and Achaia, and the word came back to them. And then to see Paul's affection for them. What a deep, deep relationship and care and concern he had for them. And how he was so worried for them that he was willing to sacrifice and send Timothy on ahead to be sure that they were okay. And then in verse 6 it says this. This will be our primary text. But now that Timothy has come to us from you and has brought us the good news of your faith and love, and reported that you always remember us kindly and long to see us, as we long to see you. For this reason, brothers, in all our distress and affliction, we have been comforted about you through your faith. For now we live, if you are standing fast in the Lord. For what thanksgiving can we return to God for you, for all the joy that we feel for your sake before God? As we pray most earnestly, night and day, that we may see you face to face and supply what is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, as we do for you, so that he may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all of his saints. And so that's going to be our focal point tonight, especially verse 10. We're going to focus in on verse 10 most of all. Let's pray. Jesus, we pray that as we have heard Paul and Timothy and Silvanus' heart towards the believers in Thessalonica, and as Paul is giving as Paul is talking to them about his deep love and compassion and desire for them to excel in the gospel and in their faith, we pray that you would open up our hearts to really hear and understand what your Spirit would say to us about this tonight. Don't let this just be a history lesson. Don't let us just say in our hearts, oh, that was really nice that Paul and Timothy and Silvanus felt that way about the people in Thessalonica. Let us see and know and feel personally as your Spirit speaks to us the reality of what this text has to say to us and how it can change us. How we can be different because by your Spirit we get to come face to face with you through your Word. Let that be a reality tonight. Let us know it by the power of your Spirit. And we pray that it would happen, and we pray that we would be changed. Jesus, we ask this in your name. Amen. I want to say this first. There are many times that I think about the epistles in the New Testament, the epistles and the letters. So we get past Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and Acts, which are narrative. Basically, they're telling the story of Jesus and the Acts of the apostles in the early church. Once we get past the narrative and get into the epistles, which are the letters, my confession to you is that often I think about these letters as if they're just containers of doctrine. Does that make sense? I think about them as really just, sure, Paul had to write a letter to somebody, but really the whole point is that it's doctrine. It's just statements of truth about Jesus or about the way the church works or about the way I'm supposed to live as a Christian. And really, the way I approach them sometimes is to go into the epistles and to pick out principles or rules. Those things that are imperatives, where there's a command from Paul or from Peter or from the author of Hebrews or whatever it is. To look at the epistles as if they're really just containers for rules or for principles or for little bits of wisdom to rule and order and live my life by. And I think that's a temptation for a lot of people. The reality is, although the epistles contain doctrine, they're not primarily just about doctrine. And this is what happens. See if you recognize this. What really happens is, in the case of Paul, what Paul will do is Paul will start to write a letter, and he'll say, listen, I want to tell you something. I'm going to make my first point here. My first point is that I want to tell you about Jesus, salvation, and what salvation means and how he saved you. Oh man, let me just glory in Christ for a minute. Let me just talk about how awesome Jesus is. He is the most holy. He sits in the right hand of God. I was making a point here. A chapter later, he gets back to his point. Right? You ever notice how he does that? And other authors in the New Testament, they start to make a doctrinal point, and then they just start to worship for like three paragraphs. It's hard to read sometimes because you're looking for the point, you know? And then Paul just starts rambling on about the wonderful, beautiful, amazing Jesus, sovereign God of the universe. And you're like, I'm looking for the point of doctrine here. It's going to wait until, okay, Paul, we'll just wait for you to be finished worshiping. And when you're done talking about how awesome Jesus is, then we'll get down to the doctrinal point. You guys see that? It's not just, if Paul wanted to just give doctrine, he would have sent a list to the churches, not a letter. He would have sent the modern day version of the Ten Commandments to the churches. He would have said, listen, I'm going to give you 10 points. These are 10 things that you should know about marriage. That's what Paul would have done, right? But he doesn't do that. What he does is he writes to a church, to a group of believers, He worships Jesus in the middle of it. Every 5 minutes he's stopping to talk about how awesome Jesus is, or the gospel, or glory in God the Father's plan. And then he comes back to maybe a nugget of truth that he's trying to share, but it's always in the context of the relationship that he has with them. And this is a perfect example, because he goes on and on in chapter 2 about how he just loved them so much that he treated them like a nursing mother or like a father that gives instruction. He was so desirous for them and their faith. And then he worried about him. He says, "I'm so stinking worried about you guys. I wanted to come to you, and the enemy kept messing with me. And so I told Timothy, you go on and check on them, because I'm worried. I want to make sure they're okay. I love these guys so much." Sometimes people act like Paul in the New Testament is some kind of like a heavy for God. You guys know what a heavy is? Like a muscle? Tough guy, mean guy, right? Paul's always being mean. In the New Testament, people like Barnabas are always being nice. Barnabas is a nice, encouraging guy. And Paul's a guy that shows up and cracks skulls. People think that. We think that sometimes. That Paul's like the gospel enforcer. He writes a letter to the Galatians. "Don't make me come down there, Galatians. You're going to regret it." That's not Paul at all. If you actually read what Paul has written, Paul is not just in 1 Thessalonians. In every book, including Galatians, which he is most directed, I would say. Paul's very direct in the letter to the Galatians. Even then, though, it's because of his love for them. He's not just expressing doctrine. And I want to say this to you. The Scripture, the New Testament, the Old Testament, it's not just a vehicle for God to give you doctrine. Does that make sense? I desperately want you to hear this and know this tonight. Although doctrine is contained, although important truths about the nature of God are contained, the way He expresses those truths are through story and relationship. It's not just a list. The Scripture is not for us just to go through and say, that's relational, I don't need that. That's a greeting, I don't need that. That's a genealogy, I don't need that. I'm just looking for the principle. Husbands, love your wives. That's all I need. That's all I was looking for. I just need a little help. All I need is just the bullet points. Just the PowerPoint. I don't need the whole doc. Just give me the PowerPoint. Just give me the bullet points. We treat the New Testament that way sometimes. We treat God that way sometimes. We're just like the Old Testament believers. What do? They went to Mount Sinai, right? God shows up. You guys ever read this in the Old Testament? It's crazy. God comes down. You read it in Hebrews 2. God comes down on top of the mountain. And there is smoke and fire and lightning and thunder and the voice of God. And it is crazy. And God gives Moses instructions to sit. This isn't even in the sermon, by the way. So we just let the Spirit do what He wants to do. He sets a perimeter around the mountain, right? And says, don't let anybody come too close. They didn't really need to do that. Because you know what the people told Moses? They said, listen, we're scared crazy. We don't want to get close to God. You go up in the mountain, find out what the big guy wants. You come back and tell us. Read it. That's what they said. They said, Moses, you go talk to the big guy, and you find out the rules. You come down and give us the rules. They were terrified of and didn't have any interest in relationship with a holy God. All they wanted was the rules. And sometimes we can be the same way. Sometimes we look at the New Testament in the same way. We dig through it just looking for the rules. Okay, just tell me the rules, God. Just tell me the rules. And it's about relationship. It's the doctrine about God is woven into the relationship of the people that are experiencing this, and then it's woven into the relationships that we have as a body of Christ. There's no piece of doctrine that can stand outside of Christian community. I'll say it again. There's no piece of doctrine that can stand outside of Christian community. Doctrine is intended to be put into practice somewhere. Where am I going to put it into practice? It happens among us as the family of God and among those whom God is drawing to Himself and whom we're compelled to go and share the gospel with. Doctrine doesn't exist just as a concept, but we treat it that way sometimes. We say, just give me the rules and I'll be fine. I'll just do the rules. We're not saved by rule keeping. We're saved by Jesus, who took on human flesh and who walked around for 30-something years on the earth, the whole time his eyes on a cross in the distance on a little hill they called the skull, so that he could give his life a ransom for us, so that he could take our sin upon himself and absorb the wrath of God, and in exchange give us his perfect righteousness. That's what we're saved by. Because we're saved by his insane grace, we are compelled to obedience. And so then we need to know about the doctrine. We need to know about it. We need to know how it works itself out in the community and household of faith and with those people outside of the household of faith. But this is not about tell me the doctrine and I'll just keep the rules. Verse 10. Chapter 3, verse 10. Paul says this. As we pray most earnestly, night and day, that we may see you face to face and supply what's lacking in your faith. There are three things in this one verse I want to point out. They wouldn't make any sense if we hadn't read the first three chapters. These are the three things I want to point out. Paul is praying earnestly for them. And because we read the first three chapters, you know why he's praying earnestly now, don't you? Because he just loves them so much. He cares about them so much. Because he went and saw Jesus do a miracle there. He went and he preached the gospel and they turned away from idols and they put their faith and hope and trust in Jesus. And then because of that, the gospel bound them together in family, in Christian fellowship and family. So that Paul felt like a mother and a father to them. And Paul had a deeply desirous heart to know that they were okay, that they were doing well. And because he was concerned and worried that the enemy would try to attack them and steal from them what God had given them. Because of that, we find in verse 10, Paul saying that I prayed for you night and day. The Greek word there for praying earnestly or intently or whatever your version or translation may say, the Greek behind that is this idea of an abundant overflow. Flowing, and then an extra big, huge pile on top of that. So when he says that I was earnestly praying for you night and day, the terminology in the Greek that Paul's using is this crazy, insane, over-the-top effort to engage in prayer for you night and day. And he says that we may see you face to face. The supply was lacking in your faith. Paul is praying for these guys night and day. He's praying that he might be able to see them face to face so that he can supply what's lacking in their faith. The three things that are here are prayer, prayerfulness on Paul's part. The second thing is that this is personal. Personal. It's face to face. And the third thing is that it's participatory. Paul is saying that I want to supply what's lacking in your faith. There's something for Paul to do there. He has to participate. So it's prayerful, it's personal, and it's participatory. If the New Testament was primarily just about doctrine, then what Paul could have done is he could have said, listen, I want to supply what's lacking in your faith. Which is what he says in verse 10, right? He says, to supply what's lacking in your faith. If what God wants to tell us is just about information, Paul could have said, listen, I want to supply what's lacking in your faith. And so in chapter 4, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to tell you what's lacking in your faith. Point number 1. You don't understand the gospel. Point number 2. You don't love Jesus anymore. Point number 3. He could have told, right? He could have said, Paul just says that something is lacking in their faith. Now remember in chapter 1 when I told you to pay special attention to that one thing that I said? How many of you actually paid attention? You've forgotten now. We read 3 chapters. I've been yapping. You're like, what did he say? Their faith in God was so insanely huge and crazy that Macedonia and Achaia and everybody heard about it and had a huge impact. Does that sound to you like people with a problem with their faith? No. No. And in chapter 2, he goes on about it. And then he gets almost through chapter 3 and says, I can't wait to see you face to face so I can supply what's lacking in your faith. Paul is confusing sometimes. He wants to get there to supply what's lacking in their faith. If it was just about information, then he could just tell them what it was. This is the information you need. Have you ever experienced in your walk with the Lord thinking that you needed more information and then getting that information and discovering that that wasn't your problem? How many of you know that you should be more loving towards your spouse, your children, your co-workers? You know it, right? You know the information? Right? Yeah, so do I. Knowing what the problem is and doing something about it are two different things. It wasn't an information problem that they had. That's not what was lacking. Sometimes we can be very practical and very intellectual, and we can think that our problem is we just don't have enough information. What's worse is sometimes we think the same thing about those that we lead or help or disciple. Right? So if you lead or care for spiritually or disciple someone, if you think all they need is more information, you're going to have a problem. Because this is what will happen. You will give them information. Josh, I'm so glad that you came to me for discipleship. This is what you need to do. You need to read your Bible more, and you need to love your wife, and you need to share the gospel. Do you understand these instructions? Yes, okay. So I just told my disciple what he needs to know. Read the Bible, love your wife, share the gospel. The problem is, he's not going to do it. I'm going to come back and say, Josh, why are you not doing these 3 things that I told you to do? He's going to say, I'm trying to do them. I'm really trying. I mean, I love Jesus. I love my wife. I love my neighbor. It's not for lack of desire. I want to do these things. And I'm going to say, maybe you didn't understand. Let me tell you again. This is what you need to do. You need to read your Bible, love your wife, share the gospel. Do you understand these things? Josh can say yes. Okay. We're going to meet next week. I'm going to say, how's it going with the 3 things? You know, I was busy with work this week, and I don't know. I'm going to say, are you not understanding my instructions? I've given you all the information you need. If that's the way you're discipling or mentoring or leading or fathering people in the gospel, there's going to be a problem. Because it's not just information that we need. We do need information. We do need information. You guys know me well enough now, after 8 years, you know that I believe in doctrine and in knowing the Word of God. It's not that we don't need information. The problem is that's not all we need. And sometimes we act as if that's all we need. It's just the data or the information. But Paul says, I'm praying earnestly night and day that I might see you face to face and supply what's lacking in your faith. Paul understood they had the information they needed. The other thing that they needed was relationship. They needed their spiritual father to come look them in the eyes. Because there's something that happens when we look each other in the eye. There's something that happens when you look at someone and say, I sure do appreciate you. You're such a blessing to me. Now, I can write it or send it in an email. But when I look you in the eye and tell you that you're a blessing to me, and that I appreciate you and love you as my sister in the Lord, there's something different that happens. Something else is being communicated when we are face to face. Face to face. We don't just need information. What we need is we need to be face to face with each other. If you disciple someone or mentor someone or lead someone or spiritually parent someone, and I use all those words, to me they all mean the same thing. But different people use different words for those things. Discipleship, mentoring, leading, fathering in the gospel, all those things to me are the same thing. They happen different ways, and we have different words for them, but to me it's all the same thing. Any of those things that you are engaged in doing needs to be sure that it's not just an exchange of information. You need to be sure that there's a face-to-face element to that, that there's a personal element to that. If you do discipleship with somebody and you meet with them once a week, that's wonderful. Have them into your home, at your dinner table, to eat a meal with you and interact with you and the rest of your family and do discipleship around the dinner table. Do discipleship as you do yard work. Do discipleship as you share the gospel with your neighbor as you do his yard work. Personal, face-to-face. That's the way real discipleship happens. It's not only through the exchange of information. Face-to-face. And then he says, to supply what's lacking in your faith. I had two conversations 2 weeks ago with a husband and a wife separately. They were not pleasant conversations. They're having a great deal of trouble in their relationship. And the reason I was having the conversations with them is because the trouble that they were having is so difficult and has been going on for so long that it had finally come to me to have the conversation. Do you guys understand that? Okay. Their friends, the people in their small group, other concerned believers had already been having conversations and working with them and talking to them and praying with them and trying to help them through this. And nothing has happened. And so it's me at that point, because there's been no resolution and continued struggle and sin. I was already emotionally and mentally and spiritually exhausted when I had the first conversation. And I told the gentleman that exactly. I said, I've been doing a bunch of ministry lately and a bunch of extra stuff, and I'm tired. We got started at 10:30 at night on a school night. And I told him, dude, I'm wiped out, man. I'm tired. We've been doing a bunch of missional stuff every weekend. I'm wiped. Which is fine, because I can't do anything for you anyway. What am I going to tell you? All the stuff you've already heard from somebody else? Your friends and your other believers around you, and your small group and your other people that love you, they've already told you what you need to do, haven't they? They've already told you that you need to love and you need to forgive and that you need to let these things go and all these things, and you need to communicate and you need to obey the scripture towards one another and all those things. If I say it, it's not going to make any difference. Sometimes, though, leaders in the church think that if I say it, it will make a difference. Sure. If one of you tells someone to obey Christ, then they may take that kind of seriously. If I tell them to obey Christ, that's it. You only laugh because you know it's true. You know some leaders like that. Right? They carry themselves a certain way sometimes that's less than humble. It's not just their fault. It's partly your fault too. Sometimes we treat them as if they're special and magical. If you treat them that way long enough, they'll start to believe it. Leaders in the church have an office, they have a responsibility, they have work to do.
They don't have a special relationship with Jesus different than yours. They don't have some special power or ability. They may have gifts that are different than yours. But it's the Spirit that changes somebody's heart. And not a title, not a position. And I told both the husband, and then the next night, I talked to the wife, I told her the same thing. I can't. My words are not going to change your heart. But I tell you this, I tell you, I love you, I'm fighting for you, I'm praying for you guys. Jesus has done something to bind you together into our hearts. This particular couple, the very first Sunday they ever came to our church, it was their first Sunday it was open to lunch, wasn't it? Jesus just did something the very first time they visited to connect us, connect our hearts. And I reminded them of that. I said, we've known you guys from the beginning. And there's always been, although we haven't always been able to spend lots of time together, there's always been a connection there. And that's all I can tell you is that I love you, that I'm praying for you, that I'm on my knees fighting for you. I want you to know and to believe the truth, but I can't change your heart. Just because I couldn't change their heart didn't mean there wasn't a part that I had to play. That's Paul's participation here. Paul says, listen, I want to come see you face to face because I want to supply something that's lacking in your faith. Paul recognized and understood that there was something that he had that he could supply. It wasn't information. It was more about his relationship with them and being face to face with them and reminding him that he cared about them like a nursing mother or like a father who instructs his children or like a brother. Listen, here's our application. I want all of us to think about this idea in verse 10 in these three things. I want you to ask yourself, who are you caring for spiritually? And this applies to everybody. There's no one in the room that's exempt from caring for somebody else spiritually. Now, some of you guys I know are leaders in the church. So any of you guys that are leaders, you may automatically think, oh, I know the guys that I'm responsible for, the ladies that I'm responsible to care for spiritually. Some of you may not be quote-unquote leaders. You still have people that you're responsible to care for spiritually. It may be a spouse, it may be your children, it may be a brother in the Lord that for some reason the Spirit has connected you. You just know. You know, don't you? There's a connection. And you know that you have a responsibility to care for a brother or a sister. Some of you know that you should be caring for somebody, and you're not. You're wasting your time on yourself. You're being selfish, or you're being sinful. Well, okay, being selfish is sinful. You're being selfish. You're either being lazy and just doing nothing. My time is my own. I don't have time to mess with other people. Or you're actively engaged in sin. I'm going to do this even though I'm not supposed to. I know that it's disobedience to God, but I'm so busy pursuing this thing, this idol, that I don't have time to serve or love or care for anybody else. And the Holy Spirit would say, stop that. Stop that. Stop that. Look around. Look around. Not just in this room physically, but look around wherever you are. Your home, your workplace, where you fellowship, whatever it is. Look around and ask the question, who am I supposed to be praying for? Because that's what this starts with. Paul's intense prayer for them. Ask yourself the question, who am I supposed to be praying for that I'm not praying for right now? And I'm not talking about throwaway prayers. That's not what Paul is doing here. It's not like when you go to bed, now I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep, and don't forget about Josh. Woo-hoo! Done with my prayers in record time. 15.8 seconds. It's not what Paul's doing here. Paul is bleeding, he's dying, he's weeping, he's begging God night and day for the believers in Thessalonica. And you know from his other letters, they weren't the only ones on his list. Man, he's pouring his heart out for these guys. He is wrestling with God in prayer for these guys. He's begging Jesus,
help them hold on to the gospel to say they were good in their heart. So who are you supposed to be praying for in that way that you're not?
Who are you supposed to be engaging face to face that you're not? Who are you supposed to be engaging face to face that you're not? Who are you supposed to be inviting into your home to your dinner table that you're not doing right now?
It may be another believer that you need to spiritually care for. It may be somebody younger in the faith. It may be an unsaved friend or family member or coworker.
That you need to be spending time face to face with.
Not, Facebook doesn't count.
Well, they did a post and I liked it. Doesn't that count?
That doesn't count.
That's good. That's fine.
It doesn't count.
I'm talking about face-to-face, looking them in the eyes, in the same room with each other so that you can touch each other, so that you can hug each other, so that you can look each other in the eye, so that you can be personal with them, so that you can see each other's body language, so that when you ask them about how things are going in their walk with Jesus, see over email if I ask that question, well, that's one thing. But if we're sitting in the same room, if you're at my house and we're having dinner and I look you in the eye and say, how's your walk with Jesus going? It's a whole different thing going on, isn't it? It's a whole different thing going on. I can encourage you, I can love you, I can gospel you in a different way when we're face to face. In what ways are you supposed to be supplying something that's lacking in somebody else's faith?
The simplest way that we supply what's lacking is just to gospel each other. And I know that's a broad term when we use it that way as a verb. Yeah, gospel each other. I thought the gospel was a noun. Isn't it just information that we share?
You guys know the gospel is a noun, it's a verb, it's an adverb, it's an adjective. The gospel is something that happened to you, is happening to you, will happen to you.
And when we talk about it, we're gospeling each other. But I just remind Josh, isn't it crazy that Jesus died for us? It sounds kind of corny at first. It's like, really? You just said to me, isn't it crazy Jesus died for us? No, seriously, dude. Let's just think about it for a minute. Just for a minute. Just the two of us. Forget everybody else is here. We'll practice this. Personal, face-to-face. Just be supplying something that's lacking. Just to meditate. I'll never get out of the gospel for a minute. It can be that simple. It can be that simple. If you let somebody talk long enough, they will tell you what's lacking in their faith.
They will tell you. If you want to know how do I supply what's lacking in somebody else's faith, ask them that question, how's your walk with the Lord?
And then just let them talk. Right? And they'll go,
Or just let them talk. Hey, how's it going? I'm glad you asked how it's going. Work is going terrible. My boss is a jerk. My wife hates me. My kids are disrespectful.
All right, I'm just going to start the list of the ways that I can supply what's lacking in your faith. Right? And you can encourage and you can gospel and you can just go, man, remember that God supplies all your needs and your job is not the primary place of provision for you. And man, if you feel like your wife doesn't love you, how are you loving her? How are you sacrificially serving her and dying for her like Christ died for the church? And what are you doing to engage your children in a way that creates an environment for them to respect you? That grows out of the truth of the gospel. You'll see ways that you can supply what's lacking in somebody else's faith.
And so I'd ask you guys to look at that verse this week. Verse 10. And just ask yourself those three questions. Who can I be praying for?
Who can I be personal with and spending time face to face? And how can I actively, intentionally look for ways to supply what's lacking in somebody else's faith? If they're an unbeliever, that's the easiest one of all. If they're an unbeliever, they're lacking everything. The door is wide open. For you to share the gospel with them. For you to declare to them the glories and the mystery of Christ and what he's done. And let the Holy Spirit do what he does
he may be pleased to have them fall on their knees and say, what must I do to be born again? Or maybe not.
Maybe they'll say, that's interesting. And you'll have other opportunities to share and to love and serve them. And let them see and hear the reality of the gospel. Let's pray.
Jesus, we pray you'd help us.
By nature, we are either, in our sin, we're either religious or rebellious. We either want to keep all the rules or break all the rules. What you've done in the gospel is fundamentally about our relationship with you. And then out of that grows our relationship with others, with other believers and other unbelievers. And we pray, God, that this week you'd help us to think through the experience of the Christians in Thessalonica and their relationship with Paul and Timothy and Silvanus. And as we do that, think about what Paul expresses in this particular verse, that we would, by your Spirit, be enlightened and know who we should be praying for intently, who we should be seeking out to spend personal time with, and how we can be intentional about looking for ways to supply what's lacking in somebody else's faith. If they're a believer, then give us ways to encourage and love and embolden them in the gospel. And if they're an unbeliever, give us opportunity in both the things that we do and the things that we say to express to them the truth of the gospel. And we pray that they would respond as the Holy Spirit softens their heart. And we pray that we would see people born again. We pray that we would see people born again. Every time we gather together, I pray that we would have an expectation that somebody comes and says, I need to tell you about somebody that's been born again. I pray that that would be our expectation, and that's what we would earnestly pray for in all of our churches, that we would be begging you to save the people around us, our friends and neighbors and family and co-workers. We would beg you for their souls, and that there would be an expectation that when we gather, that we would have stories about people coming to faith in Christ because it pleased you to draw them to yourself. We pray that you would help us by your Spirit. Jesus, we ask this in your amazing and holy name. Amen.